Dear ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon, good evening, good morning. I hope that all of you are doing well in this hot period. I'm Dominik Baratner, the ITTF High Performance Manager, and I'm very happy and proud to warmly welcome all of you to our third lesson of the ITTF High Performance and Development 4 classes with Massimo Costantini with the topic Nationals. I want to talk shortly about our lesson code, about our rules. To all the attendees, please mute yourself and turn off the video. Just Massimo's and my micro and webcam will be on. Please don't touch anything regarding the recording or our presentation slides. And please leave your questions in the chat. We will try to answer as many as possible in the question and answer part of the lesson. Thank you very much. Today, Massimo and I will talk about national. It will cover the ages between 15 and 21 years. We want to emphasize what you should consider within the ages and what the issues are you have to deal with and on which you have to work with your athletes. Beside the lesson of today, the last one will follow on next Friday, ending the series with the professionals. The contents of today will be the common elements like goals, planning, training, and competition. And on the other hand, the sport and performance elements like strength and conditioning, sports psychology, technique, and strategy and tactic. I wish all of us a very informative and educational lesson. And now the floor is yours, Massimo.
Thank you very much, Dominik, and welcome to all of you to this third lessons or class, let's say. And guys, we have so much to say today to share with you. In Italy, we used to say we have a lot of meat on the fire, you know, so there is really, really rich, rich class today. Again, I will have the help of Dominik to cover some topics. Actually, I also have one question for all of you. So get ready to write few things, just one word actually, on the chat. So yes, today we are talking about the nationals, and I would call it's performance time. You know, so we have kids from 15 years old to 21 years old already achieved something, and what to consider. So I just put a few things, of course, assessment, training, competition, where to go, what to do, what is better for me at this age or the other age. And then, of course, we have to cover now the things regarding the training, periodization, specific fitness, psychology, of course, techniques, tactics, all the things that you are quite familiar, I guess. Then different scenarios, opportunity to travel. Now it's time for them maybe to travel more than before. And when the player also having a different environment, it's important that as a coach, you have a good cooperation among the coach. So going forward, now we have to think about the background. So the other day I was watching the previous class. And when we think about these classes, once we finish, you should have one long, let's say, guide to think about and then to work around, because those elements we are keep giving to you are basically your your stimulus, your something where you can work around and you can think about and then you can develop, you can see the results or not, try as usual our regular way to do. So what happened until today? We started to play. Now I'm from the player's point of view. We started to play, we learned how to play, of course, we competed, we improved, definitely. We succeeded, but also we failed. So we have won maybe a lot of matches, but also we lost a lot of matches. And so we have done so many things. And now what to do? So let's go with our very familiar elements. And for me, you should keep these elements as your or our Northern Star, you know, so something that guides you all the time. And then there is this kiss. It's not a kiss. I mean, you please just don't misunderstand me. It's a K-I-S by Max, which will explain how you should consider these four familiar elements: goals, planning, training, competition, that you know very well, and means keep it solid. For me, it's very important that along your career, a career of a player, it's important to keep these four elements all time in front of you. So starting from the goal, so we go a little bit the same as last time. It's time to perform your goals, of course. Now, there is a transformation, basically. We go from generic to specific, and what we have to do. We have to locate the goals. We have to train the goals, competition goals. So when we do the locate your goals, it's very subjective. It's yours. It's something, as we said the other week, something related with maybe with the fitness, maybe with some particular areas that you want to improve. But it's very subjective. The training goals is more objective. So what when you are there, what you want to achieve, and then you can set up the goals for the objective, and then the condition goals, of course, not depending only from us. So we have to consider that we have the opponents. So opponents have the same, same will to do, same skills, more skills. So our performance is not, totally comes from us, but conditioned by the opponent's skill. Regarding the planning, this time we have different things, and Dominic will speak later a bit more on this. The planning, we have different planning at this stage because we can have the daily routine planning, the individual planning, but also maybe we are a part of a club, and maybe we are a part of a national team. So each of these institution, we can call like that, they have also their planning. So you see that our activity, our planning, is going to, you know, to mix, and it is very important that as a coach you try to have a very clear idea what you want to do with your players. So consider these different aspects. Training, of course, at this stage, as we said before, we have learned, we are improving. It's time to perfect. From my point of view, it's time that you are going to develop your personality, your body, your strokes, of course, everything coming better, bigger, and so on. So training in this phase is to make something free from faults. How many times we say to the kids, you know, we have to keep the ball on play, try to avoid the mistake. So this is the time to focus on this. So to go to the next level, of course, being demanding, working after time. If you finish your work with the kids, maybe the kids asking additional work, well, very welcome, I would say. And then, of course, it requires adaptation to perfect your techniques. From my point of view, techniques is absolutely essential. So there is no champion without good techniques. So, or very fine techniques. Research, as we said the other day, and learn and teach. Why I'm saying teach? Because you, as I said, you know, you are start getting Good, but there are other kids behind you. You know, they are starting the same process, so they will look at you as someone, you know, to emulate, to do, you know, to copy. So be ready when we work with those kids that they have also that that role as well. Regarding the training, I have done this for your help, this kind of pathway, let's call like I call a valid routine. And what we have to do in this phase is to consolidate the techniques, is to definitely to get more aware of your abilities, capabilities, and the things you can do and things you cannot do. So what to do? Push yourself. Use the footwork as a very, let's say, element to drive yourself, to do the best, to work hard, to feel the confidence that actually, you know, I can cover the entire table, there is no problem, because I feel confident that through the training I can reach that level of confidence that gives me a free opportunity to work anywhere, let's say. Let's say that the drills, it's, you know, we need the drills to control the our game, to control the situation, to, as I said, to consolidate our techniques, can be in the block, can be attack, can be the combination of strokes, and so on. Then we have a tactic part one, I would call, means be prepared. The tactic part two, which is the game mode. So many times during a session, we go for, a partial tactic drills, where maybe we can focus on a few things, but then maybe we go for the full, you know, game-like situation. And this is what I call. So the objective of this is definitely to have at the end a verification process. In the training, being in the area of training, you all know the multi-balls drills. So multi-balls, you can have it many use of the multi-balls, and I have indicated a few, of course. What is the purpose of the multi-balls? Of course, maybe to keep a certain intensity and to have the feeling of a player to realize what he's able or she's able to do. So when we have the multi-balls, we can have definitely to make our best, so we can challenge ourselves. You are at the other side, you are sending the ball, you are the feeder, and then you can put the players, you know, okay, let's do today, let's go for 50 balls cross court and without making any mistake. So the players immediately is under the challenge, and then he wants to make his or her own record. Maybe first time can be 40, second time 42, 43, and then it gives the players that ability, you know, to control their abilities. Then we have more skills, so we can learn. Just recently, I came across one video on YouTube that was very, very interesting. There was, you know, very well, Mr. Liu Guoliang and Xu Xin. Okay, also we can talk a little bit next week, I understand, but I want to give you this small element. So Liu Guoliang was showing an action of attacking, and he was teaching in that moment. In that moment, the ball was very slow. The player had the time to understand what is behind, you know, performing that stroke through the position, the timing, the movement of the legs, and so many things are there. So when you are in the area of learning, I think this is a clashing little bit with intensity. So my advice is to go in a progressive way, gradually. First, you make sure that they understand, they learn the biomechanical action, the timing behind, and make them, metabolize, make them understand. And then slowly, slowly, you can go faster and faster in order to feel that, okay, that new action now is working very well. And then, of course, you transfer to the regular table with the regular drills or game, and you try to apply over there. But many balls also, from my point of view, it's important that age, again, you know, just think about who you have in front. 15 years old, they have so much to express. They want to do a lot of things, but they don't think enough. So if you notice, when they do the many balls, you send the ball, and then they hit the ball exactly in the same way, exactly in the same placement, with the same speed, with the same, so there is no, let's say, process in them to think about. So you have to remind them, look, the table is quite big. There is not only that place where you have to play. So let's go and then play meaningfully, you know. So one time you want to play cross court, one time you want to play the down line, then a little more angle, and so many combination. Give the habit for them to, you know, to develop this this skill, because it will come in their help when they are there to decide where to place the ball. So placement, we will see later on, it's a part not important, extremely important. And another part is to, you know, to put them what we call out of comfort zone, you know. So this is your ability to see. It's not the same as a challenge, you know. So where you can reach, you know, what is your best performance, how long you can sustain, how long you can keep with the same rhythm. It's not a matter to put the target on the table or the speed. It's just to put them in a sort of, you know, stress. This make the players sort of, you know, strengthening and reinforcing their abilities, especially mental abilities. At the end, also here, what is the result of this is to getting stronger, getting better. Always with the same feeling of the player, so the realization. So once they finish the session with the many balls or multiples, they have to feel, coach, yes, great. Today was great. Today I feel I have improved. They don't know much. I don't know how much they have improved, but this kind of confidence, it's crucial for them, you know, to come the next day and maybe next day doing even better. So going ahead, we can go through to the competition area, and it's very important at this stage to select the competition. I have seen so many players that at 15 years old, maybe they want to go to the Platinum Pro Tour. Well, it's okay, good. If you go and you want to watch a little bit, unless you are Harimoto, but we have only one Harimoto, it's absolutely good, and then you can learn. But you know, again, here we have to go step by step. If you remember last time when we were talking about the goals, there was also the competition. It was the regional, was national, international. And here is the same. So fortunately, in ITTF, we have different level, you know, of tournaments, pro tour, continental, not continental. So again, you are the main person to guide them properly in the selection of the competition. And then, of course, select the competition, of course, means winning titles, improving ranking, testing your ability, strengthening your status. Maybe you are number, 300 in the world, you want to keep this, or maybe you are one of the top in the country and you want to keep that. You have to maintain the status. Coaching yourself and your teammates. It happens quite often that you play alone over there. 15 years old, 16 years old, maybe I have a team of 20 players, or maybe even 12 players. At the same time, they play 4 or 5 players. What to do? I mean, you have to pick one. You have to go for one and then the other. So also this is important to make them understand how to proceeding. And of course, thinking big, when you're there, you see maybe the champions, I want to do like him, I want to become an Olympic player. So every single competition is the best opportunity for them to go back, maybe coming back from the airport and go straight to the venue and go and play and try, because you've seen some interesting things in the competition. And of course, this the last is pursuing your goals. When we have the competition, of course, we have a performance analysis. So the performance analysis is it's okay. I have put just 3 aspects. Because we are not talking high performance, we still are in the phase of development. Don't forget, okay? We are not total developed players, so they are in the transformation. They are getting bigger, older, and also the development of the player is keep going. So performance analysis, of course, is to balance the failure and success. Maybe Dominic will explain more. You've seen many players, getting super, super excited for winning a match and getting super, super depressed when having a bad defeat. So it's important also to assist them in this part, teach them that table tennis is made by failure and success. So this is the base where we have to start. Then we have the strength and weakness. Of course, the analysis is to understand there. The feeling is I have done a very good solution when I used to turn around, stepping around, something like that. But then also sometimes I got caught because the opponent played to my, down line, my forehand. So that is a moment that you think about, and it's coming to the memory actually. So what was the memory of your experience that you can have the best use of the experience to use the next time? We said the other day, you remember, that kids they get a little bit sometimes shocked for something, sometimes super excited for something else. When you get super excited, of course the confidence level increase. When you get upset, you have a sort of a drop. So this is very important to make them aware about this, and then of course to get ready any time. So the sport performance element, of course, very well. Also, again, they are quite familiar to you: fitness, techniques, sports psychology, strategy, and tactics. And for now, I would stop here. Dominic, you can take over, and please illuminate us about fitness. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Massimo, for this great lecture, first part of the lecture. And as Massimo mentioned, it's time to move slowly but surely from the athletic formation of the athlete to the specialization of the, as Massimo called it, time for the so-called performance time. The primary goal of any sports training is the improvement of competition efficiency, performance, and the achievement. And we have indicated in our last lesson related to the hopes that the young athletes, they are not merely small adults. Their bones, ligaments, and muscles are still growing. So each phase has its main task to focus on. We will address today the following topics related to fitness. It will be the periodization part one, then the exercise methods, then going over to the endurance and strength, which gain more and more importance in these ages, over to the diagnostics, and ending it with the testing. And I would like to start with the periodization, the part one. So what is periodization? It's the systematic division of a season into phases. And what are the further goals of the periodization? It's to develop the sport-specific fitness levels, to minimize or avoid even the periods of burnout and exhaustion, and to maintain effective level of training. And of course, the main goal is to be at the peak level at the right moment. Let's have a look on the principles of the training. And it's very great, in my opinion, to explain it with an acronym called SPORT. So the first letter stands for specific, S. You have to plan and work precisely. Second one is P, progression. The goal is to have a continuous progression. Then over to O. Keep in mind to find the individual training load and to gradually make it more difficult for the athlete. Over to the R, the reversibility. You have to work continuously on your abilities, otherwise they get lost and the fitness level drops very, very quickly. And the last letter, T, stands for tedium. Try to prevent athletes from getting bored, you know, by varying the training program. So over to the planning and programming. First of all, you should keep in mind that each plan should be based on measurable variables. That's one of the most important things. Mm-hmm. And planning of a training is a very complex control action. You have to consider a lot of things: the goals, the objectives, the periods, and the personnel, and of course also the technical and material prerequisites. The base should be on the measurable so-called quantitative variables, as I mentioned before, which provide you an objective determination of its parameters and also an evaluation of its effects. It encompasses the objective changes in the means and the structure of training for each cycle. So as you can see here on the arrow on the slide, the planning is divided in the different phases, and I would like to start with the long-term planning. It's the actually called the whole sport career, and then over to the middle-term planning. You know, it's can be, you know, an Olympic cycle or even maybe two Olympic cycles, you know. And then over to the short planning. This is like an annual plan, a mace, also called macro cycle. And of course, we do have the mesocycle, which lasts from several weeks to months. And then over to the daily planning, which it consists of the microcycles, which are one or more weeks. And then over to the training day and the smallest unit, the training unit. The next topic is Matveev's model of the periodization. And actually, as you can see here, we can see the preparation period, transition period, competition period, and the transition period, on which I will talk in the next lesson more on. But at this time, this is the Matveev's model for the newcomers. You can clearly see on the first side that the volume decreases from the preparatory period to the competition period, while with the intensity is the other way around. And of course, also the technique part gets more and more importance throughout the time. As I mentioned, the different periods with a season planning will be addressed on next Friday within the periodization part two. Over to the next slide. It's very important to know something also about the organizational forms of training. First of all, we have the individual training. The form is closely tied with the principle of individualization. It is well known that the equal treatment of no equals, you know, athletes in the training is the biggest inequality and also a big mistake. So the second form is the group practice. What is the group practice? It's very closely tied with the principle of homogenization. By forming homogenized groups, training is rationalized. And last but not least, we have the frontal practice. It is the organizational form which covers the whole team in performing the set task at the same time. Then the next point are the exercise methods. Actually, they are very important and they are used in developing and maintaining various anthropological dimensions, primarily the physical abilities. So I would like to address today the load types, the training mode, the muscle contraction type, and the load level. Let's start with the load types. I brought you here the example of running exercises, I can say, with the continuous run. You know, it's a standard, can be the standard method or the variable method. It's about, you know, in general, I mean, the training load is about the frequency, intensity, and the duration. So the continuous run is lasting over a long period of moderate work without a rest. So it improves the cardiovascular fitness and the muscle endurance. Over to the interval, which can be also, you know, divided into the standard method and the variable method. The interval is an alternating period of work and rest. As you can see also here on the picture, the heart rate is all the time increasing and decreasing. Can be clearly seen that it's a, you know, load and rest, load and rest. And it improves the speed, recovery, and both of our fitness pathway, the aerobic and anaerobic. And last but not least, we have the fartlek method, which is called in the coming from the Swedish word fartlek. This is speed play. And it's about changing the speed and also the territory. It improves the recovery time and both aerobic and anaerobic fitness, and is highly recommended for sports with speed changes. So also very important and very good for table tennis. Let's have a closer look to the interval method. Here you can see an example of the aerobic high intensity intervals to improve the VO2 max. And you can see here the warm-up starts with, and the percentage is related to your maximum heart rate frequency. So you start with a run with a warm-up 60 to 70% for 10 minutes. Then you do the interval, first interval 85 to 95% for 4 minutes. Then you have an active pause, active rest, we call it, again back to 60 to 70%. And then you repeat the same for 3 more times. And then you do the cool down. So altogether 45 minutes. It's a great, great you know, method to practice your physical, your endurance abilities. The next thing is the training mode. The exercises can be static or dynamic. So it's also very much, you know, you have to consider what is more needed in your sport or actually in the current period of the practice. Over to the muscle contraction types. So we do have 3 types of muscle contraction, and you can see the different types of the muscle contraction in the picture with our very sportive athlete, who is actually really well trained, I have to say. I would like to start with the picture on the left side. It shows the concentric muscle contraction. It's the shortening movement of the muscle. Then in the middle, you can see the eccentric. It's the lengthening movement of the muscle, or also the resisting movement. And last but not least, we do have the isometric method. It's the constant holding, and also the muscle tone stays the same. And then the last point is the load level. And here I'm going to show you again interval training methods, which start from the extensive interval method over to the intensive interval method and ending with the maximum interval method. So you can clearly see from the volume, from the distance, that the distance decreases while the rest interval duration and the pace, the intensity increase. Let's go over to the endurance and have a little bit a closer look. And first of all, we have to say that in a sport like table tennis, which is not really fully endurance based like cross country or cycling, etc. It's about to build up a solid endurance base to be able to sustain first high performance through the hard training. And the second point is the long lasting competition days and to have a faster recovery after the high intensity practices. Table tennis is actually in the mixed zone. So the aerobic pathway, as mentioned last time, dominates, but the anaerobic alactic is also present, while the lactic, anaerobic lactic, it occurs just in a very, very few situations, as mentioned in the previous lesson. And over to the strength, and I would like to address the topic of the advantages of the exercise machines compared to the free weights training. So what are the advantages of the exercise machines? It provides more safety, the movement diversity, and the simple use. And on the other hand, we have the free weights. So it's more for the advanced athletes, I would say, but you should also, you know, consider and start to work with your athletes slowly but surely on those exercises, because it's has a very good total body effect and also the exercise specificity. But we have also to consider, of course, the age of the athlete. So this is the crucial period for the maximum improvements in the strength differs between the male and the female athletes. So the female athletes, they enter this period of the maximal improvements right after the peak high velocity, how it is called, while for the male one, it doesn't begin until 1 or even 1.5 years following the peak high velocity phase. So that is one of the reasons why the female athletes are more often injured in their late teen years, I have to say. And in the best case, in mentioned like last Fridays, the athletes, they should be already trained with proper strength techniques to this time, so that he, she, you know, is prepared and the injury risk is much lower. Of course, it's also very much about the athletics background, as mentioned last time, where to start at. So, but if the athlete has gone through all the resistance phases, so then with the age of 14, 15, it's about to progress to the more advanced youth programs. So the sport-specific components, also to, you know, use new exercise technique and to increase the volume. And the neuromuscular adaptations are from the highest importance in this age. From 16 years to the older ages on, it is about to let the athlete begin, you know, to enter so-called entry adult programs regarding to their level, you know. But bear in mind, all the background knowledge has been mastered and a basic level of training experience has been gained so far. Keep in mind that the gender plays an essential role, as I mentioned before. Beside that, of course, we also do, I haven't listed it here, but we have the own body weight method, but especially also with the own body weight method, the technique has to be very, very good, because think about doing push-ups, you know, and if the athlete has between 60 and 80 kilograms and you are doing the push-up with a wrong technique, then you could destroy a lot. So over to the sports preparation process optimization. So as we mentioned before, it's all about the planning, the goals and the periodization. But then of course, then it's about how does the coach set up the procedure of the practice, which methods does he use and so on. And then it's about the training implementation. So, and then after that, we can see clearly the training effects. And with the training effects, we are going to the sport diagnostics, which I will address later on. And then we have to interpret them, the results of the sport diagnostics. And then it's again going like in a circle, you know, going back to the planning and periodization. Also, of course, immediately to trying to implement it in the training. But the training optimization requires a big knowledge of fitness-relevant characteristics and also the current state of the athlete. And bear in mind that each plan has to be modified throughout the time, depending on injuries, the athlete's general state regarding fitness or from the mental point of view also, and budgetary reasons and so on. And at the end of the process, it is in many cases about designing a new plan and program. Over to the diagnostics. And when I'm applying the diagnostics and analysis of an athlete, you have to stick to the following structure. First of all, it's about the testing procedures. You have to have a test protocol. Then it's about editing of the results. Over to the processing of the obtained data. Then the results analysis is coming. And then you have to present in the next step the result to the coaches and the athletes and try to apply it in the sports practice immediately. And last but not least, you have to control if it worked out or not. And the diagnostics are part of a very successful preparation. And last but not least, we do have the testing. And it's all about a proper choice, I can say. Think of what is needed in table tennis and choose the testing methods accordingly. Set priorities, because beside the benefits of the testing, you have to be aware that the testing takes a lot of time. And I would like to address the following testing methods: the biomechanics analysis. Then the second point is the anatomical analysis. Third point, functional energetic analysis. Then the fourth point is the lactate step test, which doesn't have the highest priority if we think of the table tennis specific condition, but it is very important to set up the condition practice of your athlete off the table. So it's very important to know a lot about it. So the results are highly important, I can say. And last but not least, the fifth point is the table tennis specific lactate test. And it can be done, for example, on the field, on the court, while doing the multiple session. Of course, the sports scientists have to come to the hall, but this is maybe the most important, they are the most important results, and I would highly recommend this test. And this is now for the first part from my side all, and I would like to pass over to you again, Massimo.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much. Sorry, I jumped too early. I just put one slide that was not supposed to be. But I want to make a quick reflection on this, you know. So when we talk about fitness, it is something, again, when we properly educate the kids. So we are going back to the previous class. And we bring them to this phase, and then we have more, let's say, elaborated works to do. It's very important, number one, that you supervise what they do, you train properly the way they have to do, and mainly to, let's say, to give that switch to get passionate to the fitness, because also, When you do the exercise, you have to improve your performance. So as Dominic said, if you do something wrongly, it's of course you create more damage than advantage. I remember one kid was doing the skipping rope. That is quite simple, but because they're doing wrong, the next day, or maybe not the next day, maybe for 2 weeks or even more, he couldn't move the legs because he damaged the ligaments and the tendons in their legs. So because maybe they were, you know, jumping, stopping too much on the floor. So it's very important, the techniques again is you know, assisting those kids doing those exercises. So thank you very much, Dominic. I just wanted to say these few words regarding that, because it's important for a coach to understand. So the skills, this I have put this this sentence, you can read, but I just want to give you what is for me the the skills. The skills, when you perform, is like a language, you know. So the strokes, let's call the strokes like words, and the rally is like a sentence. So we have to follow the proper let's say, a procedure when we are going to develop those things, you know. So the strokes itself, okay, I can do many things, but then if I don't have a proper grammar, let's say, so the proper techniques to apply, to put together, and then it's very difficult. So consider this aspect, that it helps you to have the best success when you work with the kid, you develop and you bring you take him, her to the next level. So last time, if you remember, we have discussed regarding the discipline. So at this point, I just want to refer the discipline that moves to a different areas, let's say like that, because we are going to perform on the competition. So now I have to be, you know, aware of what I can do. So of course I know that I'm becoming a teenager, adult. I can be role model, a medium, part of the environment. Grow the meaning of sport. Grow as a person. Sorry, but I believe this there is a mistake, but anyway, don't consider this become a medium, because we don't need to become a medium to perform in table tennis. Sorry for this small mistake. So I was saying that now the discipline goes on our techniques and tactics, especially tactics. So it's important that they know what they are, who they are, and what is their role in that moment. So in this stage, we have to refine the techniques. The techniques, I have listed the most important in this moment of their development. So timing, anticipation, connections, or transition. We already seen the very first time, actually, the very first class. Speed, footwork one, footwork two, and block. So let's go one by one. What are this part? So timing. I would say that in table tennis there are endless combination. It's essential. We have to learn that table tennis is a rhythm game. Of course, there are other complications like spin and other stuff. But at the end, you know, is the timing that supervised everything. So how many they are? Of course, they are so many. They are infinite, I would say, you know. So the moment the ball bounces on the table until it's completing the trajectory, we have an endless place where we can endless point where we can impact the ball, and the ball can change the speed, can change the trajectory. So training them in managing different timing means to have more control when they have to face some let's say unexpected situation. So how many times we have seen our players making some such a trivial mistake, some silly mistakes? Why? Why we don't understand that? We thought that was very easy. How can you miss that ball? Well, trust me, most of the time was because the rule changed. So when we play, we get in a sort of continuous flowing. And then if something get interrupted because the opponent's skill, or just think about when the ball touches the net. Can you imagine when the ball touches the net? You expecting certain speed, and then ball touches the net, and then boom! I cannot manage. So this is, of course, is the extreme example. There are some other, but. The other day, I've seen one really unbelievable. That was Malong. Was playing by Malong. Okay, this is a very, very high performance, let's say, Malong and Kanak Jar from USA. So they were very good, really. And then somehow Kanaka played a very soft backhand control or forehand, I don't remember. And Malong made such a silly mistake on that ball. That was easy ball, but because it was this change of rhythm, he could not handle. Yes, it looks something difficult to accept, but it happens like that. So it happens any time of our career. Anticipation, I think this is a part that we all know, and the kids they are very, let's say, active in this area, because they sometimes they rush a lot, they want to do their best skills, they want to win the point. So when we combine the techniques with some situation where you have to, for example, to anticipate a certain serve return or stepping around again, or maybe thinking where to hit and when to expect the ball coming. So this anticipation is a very slow process, I have to say. It's a very slow process, but it's very important that also they learn how to manage the anticipation. And again, it comes with the experience where, you can assess whether that was good or not. One thing I pointed out was the tendency and attitudes, So as a coach, I think it's important to observe the players to see what are the first move. Yes, I said the first move, because many players can, identify themselves through the first move. Can be the right leg going forward, the movement of the hip moving, to give more space to the forehand, or maybe shifting the body to the right because they want to. So, actually, when I used to coach, my focus in the first 10 points was only on the opponents. I tried to see what was the tendency, the attitude of the player, in order to help my kid and the other, so to expect at least to give a sort of alert, So they look, they pay attention, because he wants to step around quite often, So remember that because when they are there, they don't think too much. So you are there to help them. And yes, of course, there is this instinct from the players, young players, so we have to, they don't have the full awareness of what they can do, so it's important that you guide them properly. So don't think that instinct is a bad thing. It can be also a very important thing. Many times you win the point because your gut, your instinct to do one thing that you didn't expect, so maybe you feel that okay, this ball he should push, and maybe he risks to attack because the ball was half long, and maybe he made the point. That was his feeling, that was his instinct. And then we have to understand how to manage the player when it comes to that thing. Connections. Okay, I have made a little change. You remember the first lesson I put. If you have invested well, then when they were kids, at this stage we should see our game, watching our players with the harmonious movement and fluid transition. This is what I have written. Yes, because the transition and the connection while you play, it's crucial to avoid a lot of mistake, to keep your consistency in the rally, not having the sort of a break. You remember we said that the movement starts when the ball gets in play, and the movement should not stop. So it keeps going until, of course, unless the ball going out on the net. But so we have to have that sort of circle, let's say, continuous movement, connection, backhand and forehand, maybe forward, backwards, so many things, and I call that connection. How we can improve those? Yes, of course, we have seen with the predictive drills to make some sort of mechanization of the strokes, unpredictive drills where you can try to manage while the ball is more random, and in combination with anticipation, which is referred more with the match. So after the match, you should try to, as we said before, to analyze a little bit, see, from that backhand to wide to the forehand, my connection was not that good. I mean, I reached the ball, but then I sent the ball too easy, and then he won the point, he won the game, and maybe he won the match. So those points are very very important. At this time we go to talk about the spin and speed. Yes, I said which of the two. I think we should learn both, because these two kids normally tend to go for speed. They want to play speed because it's the feeling, is the way they show their best ability to prevail, to dominate on the other. But at the end, we have just to consider that we have to win the point. We have to win the point, and we can win point in many different ways. So of course we can use the spin as the, you know, starting. The third ball attack can be, we will see later on, and then speed to try to finish. So spin, of course, is related with the timing. We can have a different way to perform the spin. We can anticipate, we can wait at the peak. You remember, wait the ball reaching the peak. Why we say wait the ball reaching the peak of the bounce? Have you thought about this? Because basically, when we play table tennis, we don't have a point of reference, but the highest point, it's something that is visible, you know, something that we can really say, who's there? So my focus gets, selective in that point. But if I say ascending trajectory or descending trajectory, it's thank you, coach, but when? How much descending? It's 2 centimeters, 3 centimeters? I have to wait 1 second? So it comes difficult, you know, to, and this we have to check the results of the of that stroke. If there are so many players that they develop their skill by waiting the ball sometimes under the table. We have had, you remember, Timo Boll, and then he's one of the best skill is the spinny ball. Is the spinny ball on the third ball. So he waits the ball slightly out, and he brushed the ball with unbelievable good spin with 2 options. One is to win the point because the opponent blocks out, or maybe risk counterattacking, or maybe having the opportunity to finish the ball, so to play another ball with speed. Yes, more or less for the speed is also the same way. We can have when you are in the multiple session, you can teach them how to anticipate hitting the ball quite early, or maybe wait longer, or maybe wait. Let's see how it works, the speed, when you weigh too much the ball outside the table, when almost going down, you know, underneath it, under the table. Let's see how you can perform a good. So it is all part of general, you know, knowledge and the big, let's say, baggage of skills that the players can collect, and your job is then to, you know, to take the hand luggage with the best skills and go to perform in the competition. Here we have a footwork 1 and 2. Why? Because this is a part that age again, coming with the good work made before. to me is the real deal, you know. So footwork let's say, everything but cyclic. I mean, it's not that we have to run continuously or doing swimming continuously. Our footwork should be trained in such a way where actually we have to control all the situation. So how many times we have said, bend your legs, yeah, bend your legs, let's go, come on, and then, but why we say bend your legs? So what is the reason behind? And now comes all the reason. So we have to have a fast, quickness, rapid and specific. You cannot do if you're standing. That's when you stand, you can only walk, actually. So quickness, explosiveness, of course, you know, because while you bend and you move this body going up, this creating a lot of energy, which will be transferred on the racket and the ball. Steadiness, of course. Once you perform the strokes, are we agree that the balance is very important? What if you lose the balance? You made unbelievable good strokes, and then you lose the balance, the other one maybe controlled the ball, done, finish, you lost the point. So you have done wonderful thing, but then was not followed by the proper footwork. That's why we call footwork one. And the footwork too, we have different steps, and you know very well. We said the other in the first class, second class also, the sideways, the most classic. Then we have diagonal. So once we move from the back end corner a little far away, you know, to the forehand instead of sideways. It is a sideways, but it goes slightly diagonal in all directions. Forward, backwards. This is something that not many consider because of the timing. Now we are connecting with that. Because of the timing, if we don't have a specialized footwork to move quickly forward, we are very good, actually, let me say this, we are very good to run immediately back. Yes, we are very good, but we are not that good enough, you know, to go forward. So when the rhythm changes, then we get stuck in that ball. Maybe we go under the table and then we return the ball very, very simply, and the other one wins. So the pivot is also another must to know, you know, and cross leg steps, and there are more also we will see next time, but let's take this group of five okay, this was the question I wanted to make. So how many are there, the block? I already put some here, but if you want to add some in the chat. So I have written spin block, active, passive, power, drop shot, you know, so all abilities that the player can develop and can definitely make the best use of the block with the one purpose. Of course, we can control the rally, we can put the opponents off balance. By variation, we can confuse the opponent, and we have so many other to prepare maybe a counterattack, of course. In training, many times players used to block always in the same way. Because we want to make maybe comfortable our partner, you know, that maybe play counterattack, spin, spin and spin. So it is good also to create some good session for those kids to make them understand the helpful of the variation of block. It's absolutely important. So type of block, as we said before, and in competition, of course, we use the block, you know, to play safe, as I said, to prepare the counterattack and also to win the rally. So that was a big, let's say, overview of the techniques. Of course, I leave some ideas to you, to think about, to process these aspects. Next time we will go even more deeper. So I'll return the mic to Dominic and for the third part. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Massimo. And it's time for the sports psychology part. And I would like to address the following topics: the psychosocial development of the athlete, the anxiety management, the concentration, and the possibilities to combine mental techniques. And the athlete has to be on a very high mental level and has been hopefully taught with the basic sport psychology techniques so far. Let's start with the psychosocial development of the athlete. Being at the beginning of the national phase, how we call it now, the male athletes can be still in the puberty, which lasts for the male athletes between 11 to 15 years. And the signs of a sudden increase of body height and proportional changes, I would say, are the crucial signs for being in the puberty. So when we are going to start with the middle adolescence, then we have to consider the following points. Within that age, it's very much about that they want to, be independent. So they have an increased level of independency. And actually, it's also the right timing to assume the responsibility of them, because we want to have later on independent-minded athletes. The second point is the role of the coach. He or she plays a crucial role, because especially within these ages, the athletes do apply more to coaches and are having a proper respect compared to their parents, I have to say. And the third point are the emotions, and they can be very intense, as we know from the field, especially. Be as a coach prepared for not expected, I would call it, actions and statements of the athlete, and don't take them personally. Sometimes it is better to let the athlete reflect alone on the lost match or even on a not satisfying practice, and come back to him or her after 30 minutes, and the world will look in another way for them, The next point is the risk-taking behavior. For sure, also we can see on their playing styles, that they are, especially at that age, especially the male players, I have to say, taking more risk in the matches, And the last point are the unrealistic expectations. So some of them, they want to be, they do think that they are already on the top of the world and so on regarding their results. And you have to try to make them aware where they are and how long the way to the top can be and so on. So be aware of that. And then we are going over to the late adolescence. And then in the late adolescence, I have to say, they are already, more experienced with the success, the failures, the potential pressure, they have faced already, and the societal expectations, and of course also the sport demands of table tennis. And the understanding and the acceptance of the role of the sport in their life should be already on a very high level. So that they appreciate, many of them start to appreciate what they do have with their careers, what they have to do, how their lifestyle has to be, and of course there is also a very tricky point, I would say. The athletes, they will reach the crossroad between the professional sport and being part of a high school, university, and to have a solid foundation, and this needs to be created also by you as a coach, to have a clear future, of also the other aspects beside the sport. Going over to the next point, it's the anxiety management and I have to say, the use of the relaxation techniques, as I mentioned also in the previous lecture, it's from the highest importance. It's so much needed in this, especially in the sport, I mean in general in life, but especially in the sport and high performance sport. And if you want, you know, to have them in your blood, I can say, then you have to work on them on a daily basis and use them or lose them. Also, this quote counts for this topic, you know. And, you know, the athlete's performance can be very much, you know, harmed, you know, if the athlete is too anxious, you know. But we have to differ between being anxious and excited, because you know, some athletes, they do not know the difference between being nervous and excited, and they have to be made aware of the differences to understand better what they need in different situations, to be able to know which techniques of their toolbox they should use, and how to use the excitement. Because actually, being nervous, you know, is focusing on not wishing to be in a bad scenario, as you can see how it is written here, as we imagine and expect it to be. But being excited is actually, if you have it under control, a very, very positive effect, and is very much needed to be able to perform at your peak level, you know. Excited means, you know, that you want to be in the upcoming situation. You are looking forward. You want to take the opportunity and accept it as a challenge. And going over to the next point, to the concentration, it's very much, you know, about fixing the focus in table tennis. And the benefit of a good concentration is, of course, that you will be able to perform at your peak, you know. But how to fix this focus, you know? First of all, you have the chance to do it with the 3PS system. The first P stands for thinking positive. The second, to focus on the process. And the third one, stay in the present. Because everything what is in the past can be changed, and don't look too much forward to the future. So stay in the present. The routines were addressed in the previous lecture, breathing techniques too. And the next point is a very, I would say also very, very good point, because a lot of athletes, they do use, you know, messages on their equipment. In many cases you can't see them, but it can be, you know, on your wood, on the, you know, on the grip of your wood, to just a word maybe, you know, or a sentence, stay calm, you know. Then all the time when you are nervous or anxious, excited, whatever, take a look on the grip, and then you can see, stay calm, and then you will focus on this. So already in that moment you put the focus on the task you have to do. So this is, from in my opinion, from utmost importance to use also this kind of technique, you know. Or yes, then the imagery, also addressed in the last lecture, and the self-talk. And I would like to show you some possibilities to combine those mental techniques, you know. And first of all, we have to bear in mind that all the psych down techniques, they should be practiced during the athlete's practice, or in less important competitions, I have to say. I mean, it's difficult to define what are less important competitions, but you have to do it as a coach. So the goal is to automatize them and to implement them with your major events. And this can be only done if they are practiced before, you know. For the more advanced athletes, I would suggest the imagery practice, and to combine it with the breathing exercise, which makes it much more effective, you know. But really, I would just recommend it if you are already having enough experience with both, with the abdominal breathing and the imagery practice. So how to do it? The first thing is cut good points in which you succeeded. It can be, you know, out of your match videos, some specific points, or it can be also a specific well-performed table tennis technique in the practice, you know. Then find a quiet place. The third one is prepare your electronic device so you can act them out promptly, you know. Take a seat or lay down. Then do the abdominal breathing like you are used to do it for 3 to 5 minutes. Open your eyes again. Take immediately a look at your electronic device. And it should immediately highlight the video. And this should be highlighted 10 times and repeated 10 times in a row. Then close your eyes again. Do the abdominal breathing for 3 to 5 minutes again. And this could be also a very, very good method to be used when you are traveling, for example, in the bus from the hotel to the hall. You know, it can get like part of the athlete's preparation routine. But the imagery can be also used for other situations, like, for example, for what-if solutions, you know, in which you can dive into different possible, you know, scenarios. Another very important area is the one of the mistake correction, you know, like the three Fs system. So it's about how to the first F stands for fix it, you know, what was wrong, what you can do better in the future. And the second point is forget about it, you know, so maintain positively, learn from the mistakes you made and go on. Don't think about them. And of course, as also now, you know, I was talking about, don't think about them. It's about the focus. The third F stands for focus, to get back on a track, to refocus your mind on the task in hand. And it's very important for the athlete to follow the rules to gain the highest benefit from the imagery, you know. So it shall be done ideally with the help of a sport psychologist and very close to the competition conditions. So, and the best would be if you would do it at least for 30 minutes per day. And that's all from my side, from the sport psychology part. Thank you very much, Massimo. Pass over to you.
Yeah, that was very interesting. One aspect you were saying regarding the focus, because this is happens very often, you know. So I just tell you one situation where you can maybe be familiar. Your athletes, your kid, whatever is was leading 10-6 in the game, and maybe happened to lose because it happens. 12-10 or maybe 13-11, and then come to the bench, and then you have 1 minute actually, but you don't have 1 minute because the kid is still thinking, how am I possible I lost that game? I should have done this, I should have done the other thing, and then moving around thinking, I should not lose, and now how can I do that? So you are there waiting, you know, that the player getting back to the focus, and this is something very related actually, you know. So whatever it was, you just try to, you know, to resolve quickly, and then think about the present and what you should do. This was just came in my mind when talking about that. So thank you again, Dominic. And we have the last part. Sorry, today we are getting a little long, but as I said, we have a lot of things to share. And now we go to the last part, Tatek is consolidation and implementation. So the kids are, learning a lot of things through their experience, their game, their strokes, but they also, they are going to, to implement some new things according also to the opponents that they, after day or tournament after tournament, they have to face. So as usual, I list some of the aspects in the tactic: discipline, advance, logic, short, long, variation, be prepared, fishing, and lob. So let's go one by one to understand what they are. Actually, there was one more I have added. It is in or out. I called it in or out. We will see later on. So starting with the tactic, I think at this stage, at this age also, it is important to make them understand how important it is to be disciplined when you have to perform something. So I said the play responsibly, you know, so because you you have many situations where many times you give up. You don't want to try. You don't want to. You want to. You have to attack, but beat me. You push. Sorry. maybe you push. So now we are going from general to specific discipline, where really you have to in this window of time. you have to try to teach properly and make him or her the right experience, you know, to use the discipline while they play the match and they have to apply the tactics and the skills. So I put there is a space for wisdom, of course. You know, they show many times the desire from your student, and then you can see how to cultivate them and see where they could live. Based on this observation, I would say that make sure the players don't get wrong habits or attitude. You know very well, right? So we will see later on when we go in one specific situation how this can be not an advantage for them, but quite a big disadvantage. And then again, you know, make your student aware about the good thing and the bad things. Sometimes they prefer to do something because just they like, and then it's okay. But maybe what you like is not giving you the win in that game or match. So be disciplined to apply the skills, and then of course test and verify. We all have this. The next is the logic. So at that age, basically, there is a sort of, automatic, but there is a logic what they do, you know. So, for example, if they do one topspin, slow topspin, maybe the ball can return not extremely fast. I'm talking about those 15 years old again and again, you know. I'm not talking the good player where you can expect maybe counterattack or very wide block or whatever. So there is a very logic in doing things, and also for the placement. For example, again, if I play one ball down the line, most likely the ball will return cross. So this is something that you can expect, you can anticipate, and is logic, because playing for the opponents down the line is also quite difficult. So maybe when we go for the high performance, when we go for the international, then we have also to consider, and we will see how to manage those situations. They are everything but logic. And again, you know, the manage the position, as I said, you know, if I'm attacking, I can expect that the opponent's backing off and going a little bit defensive. That is quite also normal that happens like that. So think about the logic behind the tactic. And so I say advance, because in that time we can also have the idea what can be now, but what can be next. It's not the same as anticipation, we said before, you know. So you try to think about your experience, try to make the best use. We said many times, win or lose is always a good lesson for the kids to learn. So just consider that every single moment is a moment of study, is a moment to learn. There is no end in this. So especially for them, once again. So just as I said before, for the anticipation, you know, so we can think how to build up our tactics in order to expect something coming, you know, from the stroke, action, movement, and so on. Another part is the surprise. We all are very attracting by you know, making surprise, and maybe at the end of the game, you know, I'm ready to play down line, fast long serve, and try to surprise the opponent. That happens also against us the same. So we try to create that situation where the opponent doesn't expect asked to play something. Can be a serve, can be a serve return in a different situation. So educate them to get ready for that. Educate them. A surprise can always be a very good solution to win win the point. The short long is so we start the rally, and of course we have to think. We don't know how long will be that the length of the rally. We don't know. So maybe we are there ready to play, and then the opponents made straight the mistake on serve. Perfect. Absolutely perfect. No rally, and I won the point. So we have to be, we have to have, through the experience, of course, this flexible mind, you know, in order to think, okay, my idea is to win the point, is everyone's idea, in a short time, maybe in the third ball or in the fourth ball, whatever. But also at the same time, we have to consider the other part, that rally can be long. So there are many players, they have a limited, you know, time to perform. Maybe because they have learned like that, they have learned 1, 2, 3, 4, boom, finish. 1, 2, 3, 4, one finish. And then over the time, this kind of repetition becomes a sort of, you know, input that will not go and will stay for forever. So again, you have a lot of possibility with your players to work on this different situation. I don't know, I give you one example. Okay, we try to finish within 3 balls. We try to finish within 5 balls. Well, let's go for in 9 balls. Who serve has to finish in 9 balls? And so you have many, many opportunity to think about. Yes, how to improve? Again, remember past experience, explore other possibility, connect with your fourth ball when, of course, you are ready to for the serve return, what to do with the one ball. So the one ball, the first ball, you win the point, maybe comes, and then you have to play another ball, the fourth ball, or can be the third. And keep going like that. So again and again and again, implementation and thinking, make them aware of the things going on. Variation. Tactics is made by variation. So, I mean, this is I call the tricky thing, you know. So advantage is to create unpredictable situations. So back to the surprise, confuse your opponent. You remember how to use the block, increase overall abilities. Maybe one block is active, the other block is passive. So I can change the timing, the rhythm. So to make the opponents, you know, in the hard time. Disadvantage is time to prepare. It's not easy that you can, you know, you can have the control, and also it's not easy to have a set range of variation. So it requires a lot of time. You have to train a lot. Then after the training, you have to test. You have to put in the competition. So there are many, many things. In fact, many players, they have very few variation. They have very, very few variation. They just go this 3, 4 combination, that which are they're good. I'm not saying that it is a bad thing, but maybe whatever we do in limited, let's say, skills will be also limited, results. So for me, results is made by many skills. And then if you look at the many players, advanced player, high performance, international, you will see that they are able to do many, many, many things. And they do in the training, actually, either under the form of, you know, enjoying the ball, or maybe also trying in the training session. Is it trainable? Yes, it is. Everything is trainable. So you have to make your session, you know, thinking how to create that situation through the drills and so on. So be prepared. Of course, again and again, we should be ready for any situation, but it's not like that. Many players, they used to get stuck with the same thing, not you know, progressing, not going over. Of course, we can have this two situations where you are active and passive. When you are active, maybe you have a more chance to control, you know, to control the rally. Maybe the opponents, as I said, backing off a little bit. And then when you are passive, you cannot control the situation because anything can come. And then you are not you're not ready to face those situations. It can happen that in the same rally also the status can change, you know. Well, sometimes we start passive and we are able to overcome and become active, or vice versa. We start with very good attack, but because opponents is quite good to block, then we are in a situation where we have to control and get little passive. So again, make them aware, make them think what is going on. So I will never get tired to repeat this. We have one, two more, and then we finish. Fishing and lobbing. This is also a part. Okay, I could have put in the techniques, but I think because the nature of these two attitude in the game, I put in the tactic. So I said something to think about, and I invite you to think really, really much. For many players, this kind of a solution is a shelter. You know, it's for me, it's too difficult. I'm not able to handle, you know what, I just, you know, the getting defensive, you know, and maybe I do the first attack. And then because, as I said before, you know, a good block of the opponents, I just move immediately back and try to recover, fishing or maybe lobbing. And then there are situations where, you know, you start offensive, then become defensive, and then again offensive, and so on. So this is a part where you can really understand your player, you know, additional nature. So is the player is able to sustain, to keep going coherently, consistently, the game that he or she has to play, or somehow you find some signals, some signs that tell you, see, he's not able to keep, and then he go to get some shelter, you know, by fishing, lobbing, moving back and becoming really, really weak. I have added one more, as I said, is in or out. This is another situation where at that age, I said, close your eyes, the kamikaze style. Maybe you are familiar on this. So where there is not thinking, there is just you know, the ball coming and they don't care. They just go and hit the ball quite hard, and they say in or out. It doesn't matter. Can go, can win or can lose the point. But that is their nature. Is their, you know, instinct again. So this is we have to guide, because we have to make them understand when we should play more risky or less risky. There are really, really many, many players. They just go and play hard. Finish. Done. So I don't want to dialogue with you. I don't want to just build my sentence. It's one word for me, and then it's finish, in or out. Okay, so with this, I concluded this fifth part. Was quite long, Dominic, and I give you back to you. I hope that you liked this lesson. Of course, Dominic will explain better, that you will have this presentation available after some time. Back to you, Dominic.
Thank you very much, Massimo, for sharing your knowledge and the ideas regarding how to increase the level of rising national stars. And I want to thank all of you for your interest and attendance. And as Massimo mentioned, the PowerPoint presentation will be sent to you via email, and of course also later on uploaded onto our IDTF education page. And I'm very much looking forward to our next lesson, and this will be the last lesson of this series on next Friday at 3 p.m. Central European Summer Time. And the topic will be professionals. And that's all from my side for today, and pass over to you, Max, and I kindly ask you for the closing words.
Yes, again, thank you very much for your patience. It's about 96 minutes. It was a long best of seven match, let's say. And I hope you enjoyed. I hope you got some good ideas from this. A lot of things to work. And again, once you have this class, you can attach to the second, to the first, and next week to the fourth, so to have a huge class always available with you. And we are here available again and again to assist you. Anything you want to ask, me and Dominic will be here. And again, thank you. See you next Friday. And ciao. Enjoy the summer. Bye-bye.
Stay tuned. Bye.